Hello there. Hi, Larry. I'm Ed Cato here from ITHACON. So pleased to have Larry Maslon on board. Larry is going to be speaking to us about one of his many, many projects, particularly a superheroes documentary and deep dive that he did. Larry, welcome to ITHACON.
It's a thrill to be back to Ithaca. I only wish I were there in person, but not virtually. I'm zooming in from New York City, from Greenwich Village. And from my window, I can see Bleecker Street, and I can see, of course, Dr. Strange's Sanctum Sanctorum. So,
oh, fantastic. Yeah, if Juan needs help carrying the groceries, opening the door, please be nice to him.
Yeah, I sure will.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's good. Well, Larry, you wear a lot of different hats. You're an educator, published author. Can you just tell us a little bit about who you are and all the amazing things you do?
Yes, thanks. I'm a regular Jervis Tetch. ready for my best imitation? Soon I'll have Batman and Robin in my hat factory.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, thanks. I've been working on that since 1967. I'm a professor at NYU in the graduate acting program. So I've done a bunch of documentaries for PBS on Broadway. I've written a lot about pop culture, mostly the theater, some movies. I wrote a book about Some Like It Hot. And I have my own radio show called Broadway to Main Street, which people should check out. We have 400 separate episodes from our local NPR station here. And in 2013, I was very lucky to work with an ongoing colleague, Michael Kantor, producer director at PBS, who's now the executive producer of American Masters, on a 3-hour series called Superheroes, A Never-Ending Battle, which was, as far as I know, the only extensive superheroes documentary to ever make it into primetime. And we have a companion book, which, you know, I'm very proud of, which does a lot of the extras. But, you know, certainly as of 2014, it was a pretty big overview of everything, really, from, you know, The Shadow to up to what would have been the latest movie then, you know, Captain America: Civil War or something like that. So
yeah,
a lot. And I hope to cover some of the high points in our chat today.
Oh, that's great. Yeah. Now, many folks watching this, and myself included, we get very fussy about projects where people analyze different portions of fandom, like, oh, they got this wrong or they got that wrong. But actually, you are one of us as well. You've been a longtime fan, I understand.
Oh, yeah. I think I went to my first Comic-Con second Sunday in 1973. Certainly been reading comics since 1967. Our mutual friend Steve Rotterdam and I used to make customized superhero models, and
wow,
the high point of my adolescence was the 1976 Marvel Con at the Hotel Commodore, where both Stan Lee and Jack Kirby signed my Galactus model. So, you know,
that's fantastic. That's great. And they didn't fight or jack.
No, I mean, they came around. I remember they were walking around all the whatever you call it, all the booths together chatting, and oh, look, Jack, there's look, this boy did a Galactus, you know. Oh, that's interesting, whatever. So, you know.
Oh, that's fantastic. That's just wonderful. Well, that's good. Well, we're so excited to kind of dive back into this documentary. I've read the book. I've seen the documentary many times. I never get tired of it. I think you're going to take a little different approach tonight. Is that the plan?
Yeah, I thought what we'd do tonight, rather than simply play a whole episode, it's still available on Amazon Prime. You and I could just do selections and use it as a jumping, certain sections, chapters, as a jumping off point for some of the stuff that I think is pertinent and relevant in condom today. Condom, I don't mean the comicdom. That was a...
We're live. That's okay.
So why don't I just start and just show a little bit of the teaser we had for it to give people a sense of what the throw is, as we say in the biz. Okay.
Superheroes are American gods. They're the American mythology. Just like the Greeks had theirs, the Romans had theirs. These are the all-American heroes.
Superheroes are really just a personification of who we believe ourselves to be. Pioneers, and heroes.
A lot of folks who came to this country had that feeling of, I could become the hero to my family, I could be better, I could be bigger.
Wow, I know, right?
Video games, television, animation, cinema, none of this stuff would happen without the comic books.
It's American. It's sort of like jazz. It's an American art form.
Hello, I'm Liev Schreiber. Like millions of kids, I was mesmerized by the fantastic adventures of Caped Crusaders, Men of Steel, and their evil adversaries. Eventually, I got to act out every kid's dream by playing one of those characters on screen. Superheroes were first created by young men dreaming of an escape from the Great Depression.
So I'm gonna pause there, and we'll pick up the train. Maybe talk a little bit about this was a documentary several years in the making. We got, one of the, as I'm sure you feel deeply in your bones, that the legitimization of being a comic book fan is always something that when we were growing up felt a little bit out of reach, and you've done so much to help fans, become part of the warp and woof of civilized society. We got $500,000 from the National Endowment for the Humanities to help make this documentary. And that was a really big boost for us. And we started, as documentarians want to do, if they're doing a historical throw, you want to start with the older people first. And we'll see them in a little bit, but I'm proud to say that we did interview some, obvious folks, like Joe Quesada or whoever, but, we did get Carmine Infantino, Irwin Hasen, Joe Kubert, Joe Simon, all of whom sadly passed away before the documentary was actually filmed.
Even Len Wein, who you just showed, right? As old, but.
Dan, of course, So I like to think that helped a lot of, with our cred with fans, that we did definitely go as far as we could to the source. And, as I'm sure you would feel and your viewers will feel that, if you grew up reading Joe Kubert comic books, Sergeant Rock or Hawkman, like you're sporting right now, to spend an hour with him is amazing. And what you capture on film is great. But as again, you can probably deduce like a great detective, the downtime when they're getting made up or when the camera doesn't work or whatever, that's the gold. That's when you really get to say, hey, I got to ask you about, you'll see in a little bit, you'll see in a second, actually, Neil Adams. And I was the writer, the co-writer with Michael. He was the director. And we went to Adams Continuity Studios, which is 38th Street, 39th Street.
Yeah, right by where Lord and Taylor used to be.
Yeah, exactly. And, all his stuff is on the wall. And we were, the camera was all set up and the lights were fixed and Neil had his tie and, whatever. And Michael turned to me and said, okay, Larry, you can interview Neil Adams. And, so I said, I just have to say Avengers 93, my favorite comic book of all time. Anyway, why don't we skip to this section, which I think Neil leads off. We're going to hop, skip and jump. So there's a whole section on Superman we didn't get to, but this is really the explosion post spring 1938 about what the world was like once Superman, obviously took over the universe.
I love it. At any rate.
Ape. Within 2 years, these guys had changed the world. The comic book publishers, every one of them said, make superheroes, give me some Green Lantern, the Atom, Zatra the Magician.
By the end of 1939, there were seven firms producing 50 comic book titles. A year later, there were 24 publishing houses, which put out 150 different comic books, most featuring super-powered heroes in colorful costumes with secret identities.
Rather like the Hollywood studios, each company had its own look and found its own bit of the readership.
Detective Comics, also known as DC or National, was the most prestigious line in the industry. Among their roster of superheroes was the Sandman, who used a gun that dispensed a special gas, forcing criminals to tell the truth as it sedated them. Timely Comics, which later became Marvel, featured outlandish, morally ambivalent characters. The Human Torch was an android who used his fiery powers to help humanity. While Namor the Submariner, the first anti-hero in comics, had a blue-skinned mother who urged him to war on the Earthmen above the sea. Quality Comics was aptly named, with inventive characters. Plastic Man was a former criminal whose accident in a chemical factory helped transform him into an elastic do-gooder. Quality also published the comic book reprints of Will Eisner's superlative newspaper strip, The Spirit. And then there was Fox.
Fox Publications was the poverty row of comic books. They're superheroes, all completely and utterly derivative. I asked the creator of the Blue Beetle, their most important hero, what was it that inspired him to create this character named after a bug? And he explained everything to me in two words: Green Hornet.
The popularity of superhero comics opened the door for a new generation of artists and writers.
If you looked at a studio producing comics, it would look like a high school classroom in the Bronx. Largely Jewish, lots of Italians, lots of Hungarians, a fair number of Irish. For the most part, it was the Jewish kids who seemed most to connect with this idea of the superhero.
You know, most of these people that were doing the artwork were sons of immigrants. Almost everybody I knew, including Jerry Siegel, and their parents were tailors, Schneiders, we used to call them, sons of Schneiders. We had a guy named Wood Ellsworth. He was the editor at DC Comics. And he was known as a company goy. They had to have a front who was not Jewish.
And women were very rare. It was mostly a field for guys. But at the time, I don't think anybody ever intended to stay in comic books. Comic books were a way station.
I wanted to be an architect, but I was a kid of the Depression, and they couldn't afford to send me to school for that. And we came from the tenements, so you had to find a way to make a living. The comic books were the only way for us.
I had a very sad, terrible angst. When people were rich, we were rich. Car, chauffeur, and we lost everything. So I got out of it. And I got out of it by being a cartoonist.
The bullpen happened to be right in the center of this building. There were no windows. It was pitch black except for all those lights, you know, where the artists were hunched over the tables. And around 3 o'clock, they'd all begin to sort of stir and wake up. And then the ethnic slurs would start going back and forth and the erasers would be flying. And I would slink into the back and put the drawing board up as high as I could, you know, to draw so nobody would see me.
Comic books were not respected in those days. I thought someday I would be a writer and I would write books. And I didn't want to use my name on these comics, this name that would one day appear on the great American novel. So I just shortened my name, which had been Stanley Martin Lieber. I shortened the first name, Stanley, to Stan Lee, so that I could save my name for these great things I would later write.
when I started, I was getting a total, I think, of something like $5 a page. That means to do a whole
one, please.
Page with whatever, how many, four or five panels are little boxes in the comic book business. In order to make a quick buck, we'd have a big explosion on one page taking up several panels. You did something for anybody at the time. You understood that they'd take the copyright. They had nothing to do with it except to pay you for the page rate.
Like other artists, Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster were contracted on a work-for-hire basis. They no longer own Superman.
When you did a character owned by the company, they owned it. Nothing. You don't get anything. And we worked our asses off, pardon the expression, day and night. It was like in a shirt factory. Instead of a needle, instead of thread, pen and ink, pen and ink, pen and ink. And that's how we lived.
There'd be a lineup of artists and letterers and colorists working all at the same time. I've heard them described as sweatshops. Nothing like it. Nothing like it at all. I loved every minute of it.
So that's the Hall of Fame, right? Of great guys. I think you.
So fantastic.
Yeah. There's one little thing that I'm sure, I don't know, sure, but you know, I'm sure Neil had prepared this phrase. You know, they created every hero from Adam to Zatara, right? From A to Z. And our editor, who was not quite as up to speed with comics, snuck in a Gil Kane 1960s Adam cover, in there, which makes me crazy to this day. But then, of course, why Ed, was she forced to do that?
Yeah, why was she forced to put the
yeah.
Maybe was Al Pratt Adam never on a cover? Is that it?
Exactly. He never was on a cover. So we looked forever to find something. But anyway, that's where we went to. But, you know, there's a lot of, I know you were talking about this earlier today, but there's a lot of discussion about creators' rights and, you know, especially with all the films and TV shows. But as you saw them say pretty clearly, it was a business for kids, and it was something was what we call work for hire. You did your thing, and you know, you never expected anything from it because there wasn't anything, certainly back in the late 30s, early four until like 41, when the Captain Marvel serial came out, there wasn't really anything that you would call ancillary income, right?
Yeah, right. Well, it's a little depressing in some ways, like when Irwin Hasen was saying it about, you know, they owned it, and they there was that acceptance. And I'd like to think that people and creators have figured it out better over the years, but I feel in many cases, you know, creators still, you know, haven't figured out that way to create this incredible property or character and then to participate in the success of it.
Right. And even I would say in the last 10 years, I don't know who, was it Archie Goodwin and Gene Colan? I don't know how you say his last name, who created Guardians of the Galaxy.
Oh.
Which when we were growing up came and went in one 25-cent comic book, right?
Right.
So you wouldn't have thought, you know, in 1969, when that, there were seven, whenever that was, I think it was one of the last Marvel, I think the Guardians were among, if not the last heroes created by Marvel in the 1960s.
Oh, just, yeah, probably just slipped under the wire. Yeah.
And, you know, that came and went. No one would have ever thought in 1,000 years that they would become.
Never.
Never. So in a different form, but, you know, that title. So I think that, you know, maybe there was a shrug when they was like, all right, well, I didn't get any money. I don't have any ownership of Charlie 27 or whatever. But
yeah. Who cares? Man.
Yeah.
But no, that was great. And it was interesting what Joe Kubert said at the end about it wasn't a sweatshop. We loved it. That was so wonderful to hear.
Yeah, also to hear it from him. Yeah. Well, one of the things obviously that's big in fandom now is Falcon and the Winter Soldier. And for those people who've seen even a little bit of it, the shadow of Captain America falls very heavily upon that mythology. And you know, when talk about dreams come true, when this debuted, or actually before it debuted, it came out in October. So the July of 2013, Michael and I got to present selections of it at the San Diego Comic-Con. And that was like, again, going to Asgard, right?
Sure.
And panel with Mark Waid and Jerry Conway, who we interviewed for the documentary. And they went down the list and they said, who do you think is the most, taken for granted superhero? And they all said, Superman. I said, I got to say Captain America. I said, I think Captain America has been through more as a hero. And this was 2014.
Yeah.
He was killed, quote unquote, killed in the comics. I think than anybody else. And obviously he's more maybe next to Superman, but to be, he's so resonant because what does it mean to represent America? And that was a big deal, as we'll see during World War II, but it's become an increasingly big deal. So I'm just going to pivot to this little section on Captain America, which goes a little bit into World War II.
Great.
The first notice I had of superheroes was when Superman came out. I was about 12, and it was right when the Hitler-Stalin Pact happened, and Hitler was about to invade Poland, and everybody was, you know, in despair, really, because we were weak and Britain was going under. And then Superman came out suddenly, and it was, I remember as just a kid thinking, maybe he's going to save us, you know?
What started as a European war has developed, as the Nazis always intended it should develop, into a war for world domination.
By the spring of 1941, concern over German spies infiltrating America was one of the many issues confronting President Franklin Roosevelt.
But I tell you, Mr. President, there's no stopping these vermin.
An army spotted with spies? It's useless.
Well, what would you suggest, gentlemen? A character out of the comic books? Perhaps the Human Torch in the army would solve our problem.
A lot of those people who were creating comic books at the time are American Jews who are a little more worried about what's happening over there, have a greater sense of urgency maybe than the country at large, that something has to be done to stop this, you know, maniac Hitler.
Nine months before the United States would officially enter World War II, two Jewish cartoonists created a character who was ready to take on the Nazis.
Captain America, of course, was created by Joe Simon and Jack Kirby. And because the war effort was so prominent, and the flag, red, white, and blue, was, you know, was such an iconic element, it was almost a natural that somebody sooner or later had to develop a patriotic character. It was an important propaganda device, especially that first cover. Captain America was throwing a right cross into Hitler's jaw.
As written by Joe Simon, Captain America was originally a scrawny recruit injected with a secret serum.
It is working. There's power surging through these growing muscles. Millions of cells forming at incredible speed. I remember these scenes, you know. We had done this before in Blue Bolt, where Blue Bolt, the lightning man, was confronted by this scientist with the needle, does the same thing to him that we did to Captain America. If it's a good idea, and if it's funny or thrilling or whatever it is, it's okay to do it at least 8 times.
This was at a time when everybody was patriotic. There wasn't a day passed by that, we didn't get news from Europe in the newspapers. And it was ridiculous not to do Captain America, because there was an idea that would have been bought by everybody. So Joe and I did that.
This is the first sketch ever made of Captain America. And it says, I think he should have a kid buddy, or he'll be talking to himself all the time.
To many kids, including me, who had friends and family in the war, he was our connection to that action.
He was a modern-day Uncle Sam, the kind of a guy that should be your friend or your son or your father. He was a symbol. Here's one of the swastika things we did that were in all over our books.
Throughout the remainder of 1941, Cap and his inevitable sidekick, Bucky, fought saboteurs and Nazi sympathizers on the home front. Artist Jack Kirby's imagination ran so wild that he raised the bar for the entire industry.
Jack Kirby's style was unique because Jack was unique. He just would put his personality onto the page. When Captain America punched someone, that was Jack punching someone he wanted to punch.
Kirby was outstanding. He had a style that really changed the whole industry. He had what we call a heavy brush, a talent to do action that was unparalleled.
What Simon and Kirby did in Captain America, in the stories and particularly the art, was blow up the page. Flying figures here and flying figures there. Nobody ever stood quietly. And they were the first guys to use steroidal muscled characters, these larger-than-life superheroes, bursting with muscles, but also bursting with action.
You started it. Now we'll finish it.
Comic book superheroes are now provided with the ultimate supervillain, the ultimate enemy, one who is indeed worthy of their powers, much more so than some guys trying to rob a bank.
The red, yellow, blue, and green gloves were off. With America officially at war, there was a battalion of superheroes ready to defend the country. Even Uncle Sam himself.
During World War II, market research showed that 70 million Americans were reading comic books. That's about half the population. For servicemen overseas, comic books were outselling publications like Reader's Digest and Saturday Evening Post by 10 to 1. One out of every four magazines sent overseas to GIs was a comic book during the war.
The troops, the soldiers, loved those comic books. It's a shame all wars couldn't be done by a comic book. We'd always win and nobody would ever be hurt.
Wow, that's what a great bunch of images and clips. My goodness gracious.
Yeah, that was fun. I mean, obviously that the war is what made comic books, penetrate the greater consciousness of America. Again, like these little things, I haven't actually seen this documentary in a while, but I've seen it obviously 20,000 times. But
yeah.
the one of the cool things is probably more so now because of voice technology and stuff, is you could actually call somebody up and said, I need you to record two lines, and they could do it. You know, they didn't have to come into the studio. So in that little wonderful panel of the first issue of Captain America, where FDR says, what do you suggest, gentlemen, the Human Torch? That's actually Ed Herman, who had played FDR in Eleanor and Franklin. He plays him again in Annie. And he's quite a FDR aficionado. So he loved, he said, sure, I'll do it. I'll just get that line in. And that'll also be part of my legacy. But again, you know, sometimes things slip by, and there's that lovely section where they talk about Jack Kirby's artistry. And the last cover is actually by Sid Shores. So, you know, I tell you, whoops.
Yeah, that's okay. That's all right. Yeah, it's good. It's funny how Jules Pfeiffer had so much appreciation for the Kirby Simon team there too.
Yeah, well, he also was, you know, president of the creation. He turned us down 3 times. He said he actually drew a comic book character like a superhero and wrote no and faxed it back to us.
Wow.
And those of us who remember his amazing book, The Great Comic Book Heroes, I'm going to presume you, like I, like just read the comics parts and like skipped over his little intro.
The essay.
But he did have some character, he did do some reprints of some characters he drew when he was 10, 11, and 12.
Yeah.
Or 13, 13, 14, The Knight and Sparky Smith or something. So I redrew them, and I like drew all his characters like begging him, like, please, Mr. Pfeiffer, this is your big chance.
Oh, wow.
And then he agreed.
That did the trick.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. I remember when I was a kid, we'd go into the mall and we'd go to a bookstore, and that was on the shelves.
Yeah.
And it cost like $12. And I knew I could never afford that book. And every time we'd go there, I'd read like a little bit more. And then
we had it at the public library.
Oh, how fantastic. So that's great.
But again, it shows to me again how you know, influential and important Captain America was at that time in particular. So let us skip ahead and we'll go to the Marvel Age of Comics, which begins, you know, you could say late 50s, early 60s, depending on where you want to put that dividing line. And Mark, how do you say his last name? Evanier? Evanier?
Yeah. Evanier. And then, yeah. But, yeah. You know, I will say Stan Lee in the Lost Stan Lee tapes that we played today, he pegged the Marvel Age of Comics starting in 1960. He said it a couple times in this recording from 1975. It was kind of odd to hear him say that, to me at least.
Well, he would know.
But I guess.
But here is, Evanier said, when Jack Kirby really wanted to punch someone, you could see it. And so here is potentially someone Jack Kirby wanted to punch. He is a great hero of mine, I suspect of yours, and we'll talk a little bit about his legacy. So here's episode 2, which you won't be surprised to learn is called Great Power, Great Responsibility.
Oh, I think I was born in the best possible era in America.
Oh, and we're getting that box.
At the beginning of the 1960s, comics like Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman, and Green Lantern made DC Comics the titan of the industry.
Sally, do your homework.
Marvel Comics was struggling just to stay in business, pushing old humor comics like Millie the Model and westerns like Kid Colt Outlaw.
I had been doing these comics for about 20 years or so, and I really had had it up to here. I felt I want to quit and try something else. I told my wife. So she said, you know, Stan, before you quit, why don't you do one book the way you'd like to do it? Something for people, hopefully, with a higher IQ. I came up with the Fantastic Four. They were trying to be the first people to reach the moon. I had them take a spaceship. The ship is belted by cosmic rays, and they have to crash land. And because of the cosmic rays, each of them got a different power. Incredible.
Oh, no. No!
You're changing. You've turned into monsters, both of you.
Oh, Reed. Reed, not you, too.
I can fly. Look, I can fly.
Stan really didn't think that stuff was going to succeed, so his attitude on much of it was, let's try it. What the heck's going to happen? Worst of the Israelis will be doing Westerns again next week. He quickly realized that there was a market, that the characters started getting interesting. People started following them with regularity. They succeeded far beyond, I think, Marvel's original intention or expectations.
In tandem with the great artist Jack Kirby, Lee created a new universe of heroes for Marvel. Each character fueled by the Cold War with the Communists, or some form of crackpot radioactivity. They were the first superheroes born out of the anxieties of the atomic age.
Oh yeah, man. A few days in space, it'll be great. What's the worst that could happen?
The whole superhero industry is seized by space age fever. The sleekness of the costumes, the sleekness of the artwork, and more importantly, the goals and the boundaries that we can break as a society.
I am the least scientific person you'll ever know. So I tried to seem scientific with our characters. I had the Hulk. He was inundated by gamma rays. That's how he became the Hulk. Now, I wouldn't know a gamma ray if I saw it. I don't know what a gamma ray is, but if it sounds good, I'll use it.
Doc Bruce Banner, belted by gamma rays, turned into the Hulk.
Ain't he on gamma rays?
As ever-loving Hulk! Hulk, Hulk!
After a very bad time in the early 60s and in the 50s, where the comic book business virtually collapsed, Marvel had suddenly emerged because Stan Lee created characters with an additional dimension to them. That is, superheroes with problems.
Emboldened by his success with Fantastic Four and the Hulk, Lee turned to a frequent collaborator, artist Steve Ditko, to weave another kind of tale.
I really hate teenage sidekicks, but I thought it would be fun to get a character who's a teenager, who isn't a sidekick, but a real hero himself. That would be a first. Okay, world, better hang on to your hat. Here comes the Spider-Man. In order to make him believable, I said, but what are real teenagers like? They have more problems. I mean, it's hell being a teenager. So I wanted to get this guy. He'd never had enough money. He wasn't the most popular kid in school. He didn't always do well with girls, but he had to have some quality, so he was a good science student.
Ow! Radioactive spider bites Peter Parker. And then, as a result of it, Peter Parker causes or lets his uncle die. And it's not until his uncle dies that he decides to become Spider-Man. That life-changing moment where he has to learn the lesson of the responsibility of having this power. Up to that point, he's a jerk. Only then does he change.
And a lean, silent figure slowly fades into the gathering darkness, aware at last that in this world, with great power, there must also come great responsibility.
And there's a poignancy in that idea that you could have all these powers. With great power comes great responsibility, but you know what doesn't come with great power? A love life. He's subject to fits of rage and despair and uncontrollable longing. He's a real teenager. He's insecure. He's self-doubting.
What makes Spider-Man such an enduring character isn't Spider-Man. It's Peter Parker. Clark Kent was a disguise. Peter Parker was a fact. He was a 98-pound weakling. His life sucked.
Even if you have the ability to, you know, swing from skyscrapers over the streets of New York, it doesn't help. That endures in the character Spider-Man to this day.
Spider-Man looks pretty good there.
Spider-Man would go on to become the most popular comic book character since Superman. Lee referred to Spidey as the superhero who could be you.
And so a legend is born. Welcome to the Marvel Age of Comics.
Choose to go to the moon.
So yeah, a little bit of B-roll there, but
love it.
There you go. So again, two of the fun things about getting to work on a document. Well, three things I'll talk about, and then we'll get to the matter at hand. When you have a good editor, which we did, Chris Leem on that episode, to be able to juxtapose that shot of Tobey Maguire dumping his stuff from, you know, and then going to Spider-Man 50, the beautiful John Romita shot, you know, it's I guess if when that movie came out, right, those of us who knew it went, whoa, awesome quote. But now in the documentary, you can show where that quote came from. You can show the original artwork.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was magical, that part. And, you know, as a longtime reader, you know, it just kind of like threads it all together and makes it more meaningful.
That was fun. And we tried, whenever you saw Joe Simon and Stan, getting people to read stuff they had actually written. So, you know, maybe you want Liev Schreiber or Hugh Jackman or somebody to go with great power, but it's great to hear it and how, you know, he does it with a bit of a wink. And I have to say, you know, to spend an hour and a half in a studio in downtown LA with Stan was really something. He said, can I go now? Have you heard enough? Can I go? No, but we don't have time to show this now. But what we did do was, obviously we asked him about the Marvel Age and stuff, but we asked him about Batman and Superman and his comments about why they are great characters are really relevant. And they appear elsewhere in the documentary. And then he found this whole, you know, he said the first superhero is the one who inspired me the most was Sherlock Holmes, because he could do all these things and yet he was a weirdo. And you go, oh, I mean, I think he may have written about Sherlock Holmes here and there, but to hear Stan talk beyond the usual Marvel stuff, and he talked about, you know, the Scarlet Pimpernel and Robin Hood and Shakespeare, and he definitely knew his onions, as my mother would say.
Oh, I love it. I love it. Yeah, well, a couple things come to mind. Like, number one, as he's talking about Spider-Man, again, I feel like he was saying, working off that same script for 50 years. And in 1975, he said almost the exact same thing, describing, like, the sidekick, and I wanted to do a sidekick, and, you know, and he had all these problems. Yeah. And then I can't let it pass, but, you know, at the beginning of this segment, when you showed the Fantastic Four and they crashed, that was retconned years later by guys like John Byrne and Roger Stern. So they crash right outside of Ithaca, right here in the Finger Lakes. Yeah. Yeah. That. So that's all part of the Marvel mythology now.
Wow. Well, yeah. Very good. So I guess that brings us to Stan Lee. I don't know, you know, you've read all the since his death, I think there've been four books at least.
Yeah.
about him, but where do you sit in the Stan Lee legacy?
Yeah, well, you know, I spent just a little bit of time with Stan a few times, and each time they were just wonderful times. And you know, he had that personal charisma, which I think resonates so strongly, even just through these cameo appearances, that it obscures people to think in a rounded or rational manner about this fella. And I think that there were so many things wrong with that industry that he was kind of a part of that, you know, pains longtime fans. So, you know, just the same way it was horrible for fans when Shatner didn't go to Leonard Nimoy's funeral. You know, you want all your creators to be best friends and all of them to, you know, share equally and participate equally and, you know, in what they do. And, you know, that's not necessarily the case. And I wish that everybody did. I think Stan was a guy with pluses and minuses, and you know, I still very much love him and admire him.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think one of the things that maybe, since you and I are writers first and artists second, you know, the pro Kirby, pro Ditko, Stan didn't create anything, boo hiss Stan Lee.
Yeah.
I think it leaves something out, which I think we tried to connect some dots in this documentary, which is, you know, panel for panel, book for book, sure, those two guys, you know, created stuff mightily, unforgettable images. You know, there's, I'm sure you saw that, there's going to be a facsimile reproduction of the Marvel Blacklight posters from 1970.
Yeah.
All these titanic imaginative universes of Jack Kirby, which no one can touch to this day, although many have tried. But I think what kept me reading Marvel, which I would get hooked on in a way I wasn't with DC, would be the soap opera, would be the storyline, the Matt Murdock, what was his name? Mike Murdock, Karen Page. His
twin
thing.
Brother, yeah.
You know, I mean, or the Aunt May, or the Mary Jane, Gwen Stacy thing. Is it going to be her, you know? And that's got to be Stan all the way. I mean, those guys, the artists really had very little to do with that. And the kind of, you know, Tiger, you just hit the jackpot. A line that will resonate forever in popular culture. And that's, you know, that's Stan. I mean, and so I think he found this magic way of hooking. I mean, I think you'd have to do a real deep dive, but certainly in 1963, 64, 65, Superman's stories ended on page 24, whatever, right? And there was no reason you would want to buy the next issue except you liked Superman. But, you know, he did these multi-epic things, these stories that kept continuing, and you know the return of the Lizard, and that was a big deal because you knew about Kurt Connors and his arm and all right. The stuff he stole from 150 different places. He did manage to hook you to want to be an ongoing, you know, who was going to be in love with Sue Storm? Was she going to pick Namor or was she going to pick Reed Richards, you know?
Right.
That allowed you, that was a lot more interesting to me than whether Lois Lane, you know, lost her compact at the Daily Planet on her desk.
Yeah. I mean, it was such like a big club or a big party, and, you know, you'd have enough information so that you were, you know, versatile in it and you knew the mythology and you were invested in the characters. And it's like, yeah, I kind of want to go to that party and I want to spend some time. You know, I always thought, gee, how much fun would it be to hang out with Sergeant Fury and the Howling Commandos, except for the fact that people were shooting bullets and they were in a war. But those guys had so much fun.
There's a wonderful article, two or several articles in today's Times, which I hope your viewers might take a look at. Two Black creators, I forgot their names, I'm afraid, but one of them, or a woman who wrote Ironheart, said, I'll tell you the big secret in writing comic books. What's really interesting to readers are the people underneath the suit.
Yeah. If you can
hook the reader on what's going on while they're wearing their suit, then you've got a good character. And Stan was the all-time genius at that.
Absolutely. So true.
So let us move on to what I think is the greatest invention of the Marvel Age of Comics, or I would say reinvention in the Marvel Age of Comics. Ooh. And you can guess.
Night Nurse? What's this part?
It's close. It's Patsy Walker.
Hellcat.
We invented it as the cat.
Yeah. Okay.
That was bad. All right, but here we go.
The gods were in their heavens unquestioned. And then Euripides came along and decided to analyze them and you know, make them more human and bring them down to, you know, to a human level. And I think that's what Marvel did with the superheroes. Maybe it was time. You know, you can't have those characters running around forever without beginning to wonder what they did, you know, in their off hours.
What are you reading, Johnny?
A great new comic, Mag, Reed. Say, you know something? I'll be doggone if this monster doesn't remind me of The Thing.
Very funny.
I tried to say, if such characters existed, how would they act in the real world? And that's where we tried to inject a little bit of reality.
The dialogue that Stan created was different, you know? It was really folksy and seemed to work.
You belong, you belong, you belong, you belong to the Merry Marble Marching Society. March along, march along, march along to the songs of the Merry Marble Marching Society.
Reality came crashing into the world of superhero comics on November 22, 1963, with the assassination of President Kennedy. 4 months later, Jack Kirby and Stan Lee were inspired to resurrect a superhero that had defined the greatest ideals of the country. Captain America.
He became the most psychologically complex of the Marvel characters. He's a man out of time, a guy who survived an era and survived a war where his peers didn't.
Can you bring back the years of my life that were lost, that I could never recapture?
It became this great soap opera of the early 60s and of this very optimistic, you know, age that was sort of traumatized by the assassination of John F. Kennedy.
Let this be our answer to the scoffers and the doubters. To those who think democracy has lost its resolve, wherever the deadly specter of tyranny looms, the spirit of free men, proud and united, will drive it from our shores.
My father was a veteran of the Korean War, and he would see that character, and Captain America would represent one thing for him. You know, me not being a veteran of a war, but being the firstborn, you know, child of an immigrant family here, I see Captain America, and I see something completely different. And I think that's what's beautiful and amazing about the character.
And this was before Vietnam really hits the fan. And before we question the very idea of what it means to be a patriot and means to be American.
Jack Kirby reinvented the visual language of comics at least a couple of times over his career. And by the middle 60s, he had reached a new flowering, and he was doing superhero comics like really nobody had done before. And so from that point on, I see Jack as a watershed artist. You had pre-Jack Kirby artists and post-Jack Kirby artists.
And then we get into pop art. And I guess you had a post-Jack Kirby artist, because I actually think that's Steranko. That's just at the end.
Yeah, very much. Did I see some more Sid Shore inks in one of those panels, though?
I think there's a little of that little run that Steranko did on Cap. I don't know who inked it.
Yeah, I think right before, like those early 103, 104, we had some Sid Shore inks in there that you snuck in again.
Yeah, I love
it.
But again, it shows how, that idea, right, that in terms of the Marvel timeline, Fantastic Four, I don't know. I'd have to parse that out whether Namor, I mean, so the Human Torch reappears as Johnny Storm. I don't know off the top of my head whether Namor is before Spider-Man.
That's a good question. Close. Might just
4-4. But so those were the two biggies. Namor was exactly the same guy that he was, the same antisocial jerk he was from the 40s.
Yeah.
But the idea that, and I don't know that anyone's ever explained that, to my satisfaction, that Stan teased out Captain America as the last one to arrive at the party. And I think there's a Strange Tales where Johnny fights a guy dressed as Captain America. He's the acrobat or something.
Right. Like a backdoor pilot, we'd call it now.
Yeah, really? It's funny. You know, a kind of tease and, you know, write us fans if you think you want to see Captain America. And of course, you know, we did. But as the sophisticates know, that the cover date of a comic book is always front dated, right? Mm-hmm. So we tried to find out, but I've never gotten a good exactitude about what the Marvel bullpen was doing. Where were they? 625 Madison Avenue on November 23rd, 1963. Mm. I mean, I gather they closed up shop for the day, but nobody said, what was the reappearance of Captain America would have had to have been within days, if not weeks, of Kennedy's assassination.
Yeah, wow, fascinating. You know, it's not, I don't mean to keep drawing things back to the Stan Lee speech, but he said a thing in the lost Stan Lee tapes that I'm not sure if I heard before, or maybe he said before, but he said that with Captain America, when they reintroduced him, he tried to make him kind of like Hamlet. Like as he was describing, you know, Spider-Man as the teen hero. And I couldn't help but notice those pages with, like, you know, the word bubble and then the thought balloon. You know, there was like a lot of stuff that Cap was thinking about in those two pages. And it did seem very introspective and almost Hamlet-y in a way.
Well, if you buy those, what are they, epic editions or whatever of that, it was Tales of Suspense, which I guess were shorter stories. And then Stan must have either gotten bored or overworked, because there's a good chunk of, there's at least five or six Captain America stories, which were really Joe Simon stories from the 40s that Kirby simply redrew page by page.
Right. Yeah.
And Joe Simon's name, I think Joe Simon's name actually appears in the first one. He does give him credit. But if you then go and read the next sort of installments where, you know, Zemo comes back and you saw Batroc, right?
Yeah.
Who appeared on television the other night. Everybody knows that. It's not a spoiler. But the amount of panels that he gives Cap hand-wringing about poor Bucky, starts to get a little questionable. But there are some amazing panels, which I would have to say would be utterly unprecedented in comic books, where some guy stops Cap and said, I want to shake your hand. I was at Anzio. And, you know, and the guy is clearly 55, and I'll never forget what you did. And, you know, Cap obviously is at a post-suspended animation. Then he's got all this hand-wringing about that. But yeah. I think Stan was the first person to do a kind of meta comic book, right? And in other words, that the comic book mythology of Captain America was actually part of his current mythology, right?
You saw
that in even in Batman, certainly not by the 60s, maybe a little bit of Superman dealing with Krypton or the Kents or something. But
yeah, maybe you could argue a little like Flash with the old Flash, but yeah. You know, but it's a point well taken, and it all seems so fresh and interesting with Captain America.
Yeah, I think with the Earth 2 Flash, it was a little bit like, you know, you trying on your grandfather's suit, and it was fun. Yeah. But with Cap, it was like reading your parents' love letters or something. It was just very, very complex territory, I think.
Yeah, very much so, very much so.
Well, that leads us on to the next level of complexity that Marvel was destined to take on, and we'll talk about that.
Great. Yeah, we were not going to do it today, but there were some wonderful Batman segments you had in there.
Yeah, they're great. We got to interview Adam West.
And couples couldn't fully embrace. But a gun in a holster was perfectly acceptable. By the time the summer of love arrived in 1967, American culture was being radically transformed. Sidney Poitier was the top box office star that year, and the civil rights movement was taking America by storm.
We're going to map out some militant, and I do mean militant, demonstrations for Marx, Mississippi.
It made sense that the trend towards greater racial, ethnic diversity in superheroes would begin with Marvel Comics, since the Marvel Comics of the 1960s had really made their reputation by casting outsiders as superheroes. So as early as 1964, 1965, you at least started to see street scenes where not everybody was white. You would see a black policeman or a black doctor, just little things like that to highlight some of the diversity in American culture.
My mind was blown. At the high school where Peter Parker went to, there were black students going. And he spoke to one of them. The guy said, "How's it going today?" "Fine." "Oh, that was enough for me. You can stop talking now." I liked that idea that it wasn't like a special thing. "Oh, we're going to go to a black school today." He was a part of an integrated school. And you can't imagine what that was like in the early 1960s to see.
We should be representative of the whole world. I mean, actually, every type of person should be represented in these stories.
In 1966, Stan Lee and Jack Kirby introduced the first black superhero, T'Challa, the Black Panther.
He is the king of an African nation. They are a super scientific nation that has never been conquered and never had slaves taken from it, which to me was just amazing. Right after the Black Panther, for Marvel at least, comes Luke Cage, and he is a bad mamma jamma.
Cage, a former street criminal, gains superpowers from an experiment in prison and becomes the first mercenary in comic books, complete with business cards.
His name is Luke Cage, and being a hero for hire is his thing. We've put it all together for you in the first sensational ish of our newest superhero mag on sale right about now.
It was Marvel's answer to the blaxploitation films that were popular in 1972.
He's like Shaft. He's like Superfly, all rolled into one. And who wouldn't love that? Except he's not a pimp, thank you very much.
Yeah, outfit's kind of hokey, but so what? All part of the superhero scene.
Don't dare miss Luke Cage, hero for hire. He's really something else. Excelsior!
Marvel's superhero.
So that's an interesting overview. Of course, I'm not sure why, but a few things, right? So you've written about this wonderful book, Invisible Men.
Yeah, fantastic.
Which I guess, you know, in comic book documentaries, you can't stop and say he was the first black superhero, except of course for the issue of Jungle Comics in 1953, you know. So
yeah, sure.
So it's nice that that book is out there to kind of give more of a wider panoply of who preceded T'Challa. But
that book by Ken Quattro is even more the creators, and many times those guys were not working on black heroes or black characters. They were working on, you know, Jungle Girl comics or Antimony, you know, The Flame and Blue Beetle and all that.
But it's again, this documentary is what, 9 years, 8 years old? No. Yeah, we made it 8 years ago. So I don't even think they had announced even like the light bulb of doing a Black Panther movie when we made the documentary.
Wow.
And there's so much now about T'Challa and Wakanda, obviously part of the mainstream, but.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it goes back to Stan. I mean, the Black Panthers roll out what is in two issues of the FF. And then he sort of appeared, before he got his own title in the 70s, you know, he kind of guested everywhere, and he was in a lot of Captain America issues. He was obviously an Avenger for a while. And
He'd hang around with Daredevil. It was like the blue and the red.
Yeah. So that whole notion though of that inversion of the trope, right? So comic book readers and certainly moviegoers would watch Tarzan if they saw, you know, in darkest Africa, you know, the dark continent, which sort of implies ignorance and illiteracy. And then at the same time, it was gotta have been Stan's idea to flip that and say, no, underneath like the middle of this continent is the most sophisticated nation on earth, which is Wakanda. And that very simple idea, you saw the machinery, you if you go back and read FF49, or I forget what number it is, but what they're capable of doing in Wakanda is, and Kirby of course can draw the living crap out of it in a good way, is such a major part of this Afrofuturism movement that was in that first movie. And I think that changed comics forever. But again, you gotta give Stan some props. And I'm sure it was Stan who came up with Luke Cage. And I know it was Stan who came up with the Falcon, which is the hero in between that somehow we left out.
Yeah. And also, well, a couple things. One, I would be remiss if I didn't mention Don McGregor, who really dialed up that whole Wakanda end of things that I think was brilliant. But also, Stan was doing it with a lighter touch before, even like Gabe Jones and Sergeant Fury and Howling Commandos. He was a peer, one of the guys, just like the Jewish guy and the Italian guy. And, you know, he was not the goofy sidekick like on Black Hawk, but he was one of the guys. And that was lovely.
And I think another prop he gets, character I found tremendously reassuring as a child, because he reminded me of my junior high school principal, was Robbie Robertson.
Oh, sure. I don't
know, right?
Yeah.
So that was the first... you know, that was the first kind of non-servile Black character in comics. I mean, Gabe Jones, I mean, was sort of, again, part of a trope of Hollywood movies of the 40s, but
yeah.
Robbie Robertson smoked a pie. He was the editor. I don't think his color was even ever an issue. He was just, you know, the smartest man at the Daily Bugle for sure, because it certainly wasn't J. Jonah Jameson.
Right, right. Yeah, he was the voice of reason. J. Jonah Jameson was such a jerk. Every five-year-old who was exposed for three pages would know that, where Robbie was like a paternal figure in many ways to Peter.
Yeah. So I think that's, you know, as we're investigating again, what it means to be a Black superhero on every level and every venue. Again, props to Stan. I think he must've, I guess Archie Goodwin wrote the first Luke Cage, but Stan certainly wrote the first appearance of the Falcon in the middle of this insane Red Skull saga that went on for issues and issues and issues.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it was that really dragged on. And, you know, I feel like the Falcon dragged on for a while and you know, eventually kind of got to a good place. And the friendship was, I think, one of the very heartwarming things about, you know, the... This is this guy's best friend. Captain America's best friend is this guy.
And again, as a media entrepreneur, what do you call it? A retropreneur?
Yes, retropreneur.
Well, I might say that the Falcon was the first Black action figure ever released, right? What?
Yeah, from, yes, absolutely. From the Mego days, they had a Falcon 8-inch figure with a cloth uniform. And that was... unheard of up till then. It was wonderful.
Yeah, interesting. All right, we'll go to DC for a little bit. We'll cover one more. We'll cover one more social phenomenon, and then we'll rocket into the 21st century.
So Superman answers by saying, well, Lois, I'm not even from this planet. I'm an alien. I don't even know if I can answer that.
But your skin is the right color.
Though DC Comics superhero stories were earnestly grappling with topical issues, the all-male writing staff was ill-prepared to handle the rise of a popular new movement in the 1970s.
We talk about equal opportunities and employment, and we mean to have it now.
We just want what men have had all these years. But we don't want the bad things that they took with them, like male chauvinism.
I was a blue-collar, lower-middle-class Irish kid from North St. Louis, and I believed in pacifism, in racial equality, and along came feminism, and I thought I ought to believe in this. But emotionally, I was 5 years away from accepting and understanding feminism.
Denny O'Neill took over the writing reins of Wonder Woman and stripped the Princess Diana of all her powers and turned her into a street-level woman. Basically, someone who dressed in really hot cat suits, went around the world fighting international crime, drug cartels. Folks like Gloria Steinem and other feminists believed that by stripping Wonder Woman of her power, you literally stripped her of her ability to be a physical peer to Superman. Almost exclusively until the past couple of years, Wonder Woman has been written by and drawn by men. And Wonder Woman is a classic exercise, I think, in watching how men, through the decades, are trying to handle the ideas of women and equality through this character.
I wish that I could say that superheroines have changed and in a way that reflects the woman's movement, but I don't think they really have. I think there's been lip service, a lot of lip service given to strong women, but they're not. I mean, they're still sex objects for the most part.
I certainly never played sexy. I never even thought about it. I think that's one of the reasons women embrace her. Wonder Woman, Wonder Woman.
All the world is waiting for you. And the power you
Gosh, in the 70s when Linda Carter was Wonder Woman, me and all my feminist friends loved it. We watched it and we loved it.
Wonder Woman TV show, particularly its first season, captured a sense of Wonder Woman perfectly. And what I mean by that is that Linda Carter, the lead who played Wonder Woman, understood very clearly what that character was and what she was about, which was peace, which was about equality, which was about challenging gender norms, which was about power through strength, but strength of will.
What makes you so strong? On Paradise Island, there are only women. Because of this pure environment, we are able to develop our minds and our physical skills, unhampered by masculine destructiveness.
Stop. Such information is utter rubbish. Can't you see she's trying to make fools out of us?
Perhaps not. It is an interesting series she advances.
After the first episode aired, I can recall having some feminists be up in arms a bit that it was exploitive. And it kind of stunned me at first until I realized that they weren't understanding the whole piece of this.
Women are the wave of the future, and sisterhood is stronger than anything.
No one can stop this mission. Least of all, a woman.
You obviously have little regard for womanhood. You must learn respect.
For three seasons, Wonder Woman found a comfortable home on the small screen. Joined on another network by Marvel Comics' first real media success up to that time.
Oh, that's wonderful. You know, I think maybe the time this was made, it was difficult for fandom or fans to conceive anybody could embody Wonder Woman on the screen, you know, beyond Linda Carter. And I think comfortably people put them both on pedestals now, both actresses.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting. I mean, the way that that television show, I think I was in college by then, so I wasn't quite a viewer. That was certainly not the way I watched Batman. But, you know, Batman, the Batman TV series sort of set Batman back a little bit.
Yes.
I think this advanced Wonder Woman who had been dormant, right? I don't think she had any live action portrayal. Maybe she was on Super Friends a little bit here and there.
Yeah, she had a cartoon appearance on the Brady Kids.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
But it was also a perfect match of actor and character. And again, like Captain America, right? I think the first season was set during World War II. And then obviously that was too expensive and no one wanted to get their hair cut, which they didn't get anyway. But again, it was a thrill to meet her. We interviewed Adam West. You know, we got a little like pushback from the National Endowment for the Humanities. Like, why are you interviewing these people? They're not scholars. And you go, man, if anybody knows more about Wonder Woman than Linda Carter, it's got to be, you know, Steve Trevor, right? So that was kind of interesting. But it was not inevitable, right, that the movie would come out. They had kicked that around for a long time. And I think Wonder Woman herself, for those of us who do a deep dive on the media section, right, the whole Linda Carter series came out of a very bad pilot with Kathy Lee Crosby. And then there was supposed to be a subsequent Wonder Woman television show, which I guess had a pilot about, what, 8 years ago or 6 years ago?
That yeah, never the pants. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a good thing that Gal Gadot came along. Do we have a question? I'm seeing a little.
Oh, yeah. Let's see. One of our questions is coming up is, this one's from Patrick Penny. Patrick asks, Professor Maslon, what is the major difference you see between pre-World War II and post-World War II comments? And well, thanks for your question, Patrick.
Yeah, I'm assuming that's sort of within the range of the decade as opposed to now. But it was interesting. One way of looking at it maybe is, maybe with the exception of the Joker, maybe, there weren't good supervillains until World War II happened. And it wasn't just Hirohito and Hitler. But remember, the Red Skull came out of that whole universe, and the Red Skull obviously was a very potent figure. And I think it just amped up the stakes for all the superheroes. It wasn't just, if you go back and you read comics from 1938 to 1941, you know, there's usually guys in pinstripe suits with little tiny mustaches, you know, hijacking trucks or or stealing gasoline or jewels or something. And, you know, the superheroes were just getting out there in the world. It's interesting. I mean, Ed and I are big fan of the pulps. Doc Savage, you can see my Doc Savage shirt, but the Shadow and the Avenger. And that's where the real good villains were, actually. Siwon Khan or John Sunlight or all these crazy absurd guys in the pulps who fought our heroes were much more interesting than the villains in the first 3 years of comic books, I would say, with, you know, Batman being the obvious exception and borrowing a little bit from the Dick Tracy villains too. But yeah. I think World War II really made what we scholars call the sort of Manichaean debate between good and evil. It really amped it up, and once superheroes came back in the late 1950s, then the villains got super duper interesting, so much so that the Dr. Doom and there was a terrible comic book, I hope I haven't offended anyone, but called Marvel, what was it, Super Villain Team Up?
Oh, it was terrible.
It was a terrible idea, but the Joker had his own comic book for a while. Dr. Doom had his own comic book. Namor always had his own comic book. You could put him in that category. So I think that gave license, as it were. It sort of was an injection of, as it were, super serum in the villain part of the world to give the heroes really antagonists that they could really, really duke it out with. And obviously when Stan came along, he understood that. But, you know, Batman aside, who was always unique in that way, I remember, and Ed, I'm curious to know what you think, I just dug the Flash's rogues gallery.
Oh, yeah.
They were like the most incompetent doofuses in the world with the dumbest powers, but for some reason, you just dug them, you know?
Oh, well, they would seem to have this little committee that would get together, and there was like the regular guys, and then there was Gorilla Grodd and Abracadabra, some guys who were like not part of the regular bunch of knuckleheads. And that was always fascinating. And man, the costumes, I know they all went to the same tailor, but costumes would always look beautiful on a cover as they were cornering the Flash.
And yet at the same time, Green Lantern never really had that. You know, Hawkman, I don't think ever had. So the Atom had the, you know, and he had Kronos, I guess, because he had striped tights, but.
Yeah, try and name one more for the Atom, though. It's like, it's so difficult. And yeah, Hawkman's guys always were kind of lame, but Flash had it, yeah.
Yeah, so I don't know whether that was a John Broome, Carmine thing, but he was kind of an exception to the DC rule. And of course, over at Marvel, you know, Spider-Man every week had some, or the Fantastic Four, they even, you know, Daredevil, who had some lamos like Stiltman, you know, the Owl
but he had so many good. Yeah, I always think of like the Gladiator would scare the pants off me with those buzz saws.
Yeah, the Matador not so much.
The Matador not so much.
Yeah,
yeah. Look good drawn by Wally Wood.
Yeah. Do we have another question? Because then we can move.
Let's go into that next one segment then.
All right, so this is episode 3, which is our final episode, and we'll just sort of cut to the chase here.
But I don't have to save you. And the audience is hungry for their mythology to be taken seriously. They want their mythology to be respected. And I think that's what Chris Nolan does. He respects your belief in Batman. People have always said, like, oh, Dark Knight is super dark. I'm like, it's dark, but it's still fun.
So what do you think? Does it come in black?
Of course, most superhero films simply provide an escape. Bringing to life the conflicts of the comic book pages, where supervillains threaten harm and superheroes come to the rescue.
The movie that changed the world was Spider-Man. It was a movie that spoke to everyone. It was a movie that couldn't be made until it came out because we hadn't technologically gotten to that place.
Couldn't do that
20 years ago. They weren't able to do it technically. They didn't have the special effects that they have now. I mean, when you see Spider-Man swinging on that web from building to building, it's fantastic.
It had taken Spider-Man 40 years to make it to the screen. In that time, Superman and Batman had appeared 9 times between them.
Don't mind us, she just needs to use the elevator.
Wait! Who are you?
You know who I am.
I do.
your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man.
Girls were going, moms were going, families were going, people were suddenly going, whoa, hang on a second. This is sexy.
You have a knack for getting in trouble.
You have a knack for saving my life. I think I have a superhero stalker.
I was in the neighborhood.
Comics suddenly became sexy.
Superhero movies provide a tremendous kind of escape. They're colorful, they're noisy, they have lots and lots of action, and if they're really good, they have some character as well. And they're the perfect summer movie.
Shut it down, Dr. Selvig.
Iron Man, Avengers, they've done a lot to actually keep superheroes innocent. They're fantastic films. They're four quadrant summer family entertainment. They allow the sort of innocent mythology, which I think is a good thing, to persist. And the reason that's good is because it keeps comics alive.
You can enjoy a superhero without ever reading the comic. You can wear the t-shirt and you can buy the toy and you can collect a particular superhero without necessarily engaging in that narrative where it all began, the comics.
Certainly video game.
So I thought I would end on a high note.
Who's that last guy? What a blowhard.
He seems to know what he's talking about. but it's so interesting that I threw in, I also picked that clip because the man of the moment, I guess, Zack Snyder, you know, talking about the innocence of superhero characters when he's done nothing but sort of whittle that away. It's kind of interesting.
Yeah, as he was saying that, I was thinking the same thing, like, oh my goodness, I can't believe that guy is saying that, you know, today. Of course, he didn't say it today. He said it years ago. Amazing.
But I think that little clip sort of begs, the $1 billion question, which I'd be curious to know what your thoughts are. I mean, we're of a generation that felt we were lucky when the Superman movie came out in 78, right? Because that was a real movie. It was the first actual movie. Well, I guess Batman would count, but it was the first major studio economic investment in a superhero character. Yeah.
The first one that was kind of serious, you know, when you talked too about respecting the mythology, it wasn't silly, you know, it wasn't like this movie serials, which were cheap, and it wasn't, you know, tongue in cheek like Batman. It was like, this is the real deal here.
Yeah. So I don't think we would ever have imagined a universe, let alone the MCU, where, again, I can't even count how many decent, you know, thoughtful superhero movies have come out in the last 20 years, and there's only going to be more. What do you think the future, you think it's going to top out or what?
Yeah, you know, guys like Rob Salkowitz always talk about peak geek, and there's this notion that this is as good as it's going to get, and we're going to be like Westerns and kind of burn out. And, you know, I'm a lot more hopeful. And I think that as you look forward, that you know, there's a lot of legs and miles left in this type of storytelling. And I think that, to the credit of folks too, they're not telling all the same type of story. So, like, to your point, WandaVision is very different from Winter Soldier and Falcon and Winter Soldier. And you know, if we can continue to figure out new ways to tell stories, you know, on screen, in print, celebrate the characters, celebrate the artistry of it all, the writing and the artwork, and, you know, that that there's a lot more ahead. So I'm super optimistic. I don't think we're at the tail end. I think we're, you know, in the thick of it.
Right. And also since the Iron Man movie, which I guess is, but there was also a Daredevil movie before that, even though it was flawed, and a couple of Hulk movies and stuff. But even in the amount of time since those movies came out, there have been new characters created, like the new Ms. Marvel. or Captain Marvel, the Carol Danvers Captain Marvel. So even if they use up all the gals and guys we already like, people will be creating new gals and guys. And all these ancillary markets, I mean, the idea, you know, you and I bond over many things, but certainly we remember sitting in front of the color TV and watching Batman in 66, 67, 68, and thinking, you know, that was as good as it was ever going to get. And we were thrilled. And yet the level of storytelling, character development, but simply the slam bang action stuff. I mean, there's stuff even in Falcon and Winter Soldier that there are moments that are just phenomenally done as pure, yeah, you know, superhero action. So,
yeah. And there, you know, there's so many little areas, you know, Invincible just debuted on Amazon, the Kirkman thing, and, you know, Stargirl on the CW has some very sweet moments, and, you know, they're able to pull from so many places. And like you said, the Guardians of the Galaxy, whoever thought there would be a Guardians of the Galaxy, you know, movie. I think that, you know, we live in a time where people can, you know, dust off and polish up some character. Like, you know, there was talk a few years ago of a Nightwing movie, who of course is Batman's sidekick Robin, you know, been around since what, 1941 or something. So I think there's a lot out there, and I think there's a lot of fun to be had in the days and years to come.
Great. Well, there's an infinite universe, but it all began. It's always nice to go back to the roots and see the men and women who created this stuff. And if it was a good idea, it seems to stick around, right? In ways that, you know, you don't see like the Phantom Detective being revived, and you don't see Ultraman or Doll Man being revived, but the good characters stick around.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And in fact, you know, when you talk about good ideas, Larry, you know, your documentary was such a good idea, but I feel like it's time for part four. You know, is there any way to do that? And have you given that some thought?
Well, I think part four would really, I mean, the third episode definitely tackles the pivot into feature length film. And it starts with the Superman Chris Reeve movie and deals with the Batman movie and stuff. I guess you'd sort of have to do it. You'd have to go further into ethnicity in comics. We got dinged, I think rightly so, for not investigating Dwayne McDuffie's
Milestone.
Yeah. And I think some of those characters are getting revived. But you'd have to take on the film stuff is now so huge. And we were just the tip of the iceberg when we made that movie, because obviously Wonder Woman and Black Panther and I don't think only the first Avengers movie had come out by then.
Yeah.
But I think the sad answer to your question is probably it could never happen. And I tell you why, in a way that makes me despair seriously, is you know all of this. You know the men and women behind the curtain. It's all about rights. It's all of these guys, these characters now become the most valuable intellectual property probably in Western civilization's history. Mm-hmm. And the Marvel was very good. They let us have a lot of material. DC said, you can't have anything. If you find it and source it, great. We won't get in your way, but over to you. I mean, and I give Michael Kantor, a legion of superheroes amount of credit, because he managed to get both of those parties. Plus some Dark Horse appears, an Image appears at certain points in the documentary. He got all those players to be sitting at the same table together. And I don't think that would happen now. I think Disney Plus and HBO Max, I don't even think we could get clips anymore, to tell you the truth. I think that would be really tough, because Disney Plus is doing their own documentaries now, right?
Right. I think
they're called like Legacy or something. So why would they want to give away their intellectual property to a bunch of guys at PBS? So I you might almost say, I mean, I don't know, I could be wrong, I hope I'm wrong, but I think it was the last moment where we could have made that documentary.
Yeah, well, I'm so glad you did. And not only from that perspective, but, you know, assembling all these titans and creators and, you know, in such a thoughtful and professional and polished way is just such a treat. So kudos to you, and kudos to Michael for all the efforts you put into that project.
And the full documentary is available on Amazon Prime, and the book I wrote, Superheroes, capes, cowls, and the creation of comic book culture, which really is an additional many hours worth of material, and great illustrations is also, it's out of print, but it's available.
Yeah. So, yeah, absolutely. Maybe we should make that a textbook, one of these classes.
Good luck trying to find it, my friend, but you know.
Very good.
All right, Ed, always a pleasure to speak to you and your ITHACON cohort. And I guess
absolutely.
I'll see you in 48 hours.
Yes, we appreciate you're going to be speaking to class again. And you got such high marks last time, and we're very grateful. Thank you for this time, for rounding out. You're really the cherry on top, our last event here for online ITHACON. And we certainly appreciate Larry, and we'll get you up here in person when the world gets back to normal too.
And I know you're a New York State guy. So what's New York State's motto? What's
Excelsior? There you go. Right. Absolutely. Thank you, Larry. Take care now. And that concludes ITHACON for 2021. It's been a heck of a ride. We're so appreciative for you coming along with us for this amazing, very different type of convention. Look forward to seeing you all in person next year at ITHACON. Thanks for your participation. Thanks for your passion. And thanks for your time. See you soon.